Before we begin, I'd like to thank a few people that made this evening possible. One, I would like to thank our president, Catherine Pearson, who supports this endeavor of our Writers, Speakers, and Ideas Forum. Secondly, I'd like to thank the Lone Star College Foundation for the mini grant that also made it possible to bring Shawn Otto to campus. I would specifically like to thank Professor Heather Scherer, for writing up that mini grant. Let's give her a round of applause. I would also like to ask you to, I know this is a radical idea, but to put away and turn off your cell phones for the next hour, if you wouldn't mind, and so that we don't have those ringing. My name is John Barr. I'd like to thank you. I'm a history professor here at Kingwood College. And I'd like to thank you for coming out this evening. We think we have an exciting speaker and topic on hand tonight. On your tables, there are questions that Shawn Otto provided to help guide you through the talk this evening. If he fails to answer any of those questions, then they're his questions, then ask him in the Q&A. In addition to that, we have Shawn's book, The War on Science, on sale this evening. It is over here, and the book looks like that. The word here is the copy of the book. I can tell you this is a fantastic book, and if you don't believe me, then you can ask some of my students right here at this table who will also tell you the same thing. It's an excellent and important read. So, after the talk, Shawn will be happy to talk with any of you, sign books, and so on. Shawn Otto was awarded the IEEE USA, also called the IEEE National Distinguished Public Service Award, for his work in elevating science in America's national public dialogue. He is the co-founder and producer of the U.S. Presidential Science Debates at sciencedebate.org, and the only person to get President Donald Trump to answer science questions during his presidential campaign. He is the award-winning author of The War on Science, which has been called, quote, a game changer and probably the most important book you'll read this year, end quote. He is also an award-winning screenwriter and novelist, best known for writing and co-producing the Academy Award-nominated movie House of Sand and Fog, and the LA Times Book Prize finalist literary crime novel, Sins of Our Fathers. He has advised science debate efforts in many countries and speaks worldwide on the critical role of science, evidence, and objectivity in free societies. He lives in Minnesota with his wife, Rebecca Otto, a Minnesota State Auditor, in a solar and wind-powered green home he designed and built with his own hands. I might also add that I found out today that his wife, Rebecca, is running for the governorship of Minnesota right now. The couple have one son, Jacob. I might also add that Shawn landed at Intercontinental Airport about half an hour ago. He's been stuck in a Minnesota airport with plane maintenance issues all day. So we're really grateful that he's here this evening. Charles Darwin once said that, quote, ignorance more frequently begets confidence than does knowledge. It is those who know little and not those who know much who so positively assert that this or that problem will never be solved by science. Sadly, we increasingly seem to live in a culture in which easily acquired ignorance rather than hard-won scientific knowledge is prized. Shawn Otto is here tonight to explain to us how we arrived at this point in our history and what we can do about it in the future to ensure that science and democracy not only survive, but thrive. Let's all give Shawn Otto a warm Lone Star welcome.
All right, thank you everybody. I think I'm going to go up here if it's all right. You can see me a little bit better, and I think my clicker will work. So thanks for coming out tonight. I want to kind of contradict one thing that John said. If you feel like tweeting during the talk, that's fine. You can actually tweet to the hashtag War on Science or The War on Science, and we can get a conversation going there. And I can weigh in afterwards too. So if you feel like doing that, that's fine. You can also tweet to me at Shawn Otto. So, okay, that's a lot more powerful. All right, that's good. So as John said, about 8 or 9 years ago now, a friend of mine and I, Matthew Chapman, who happens to be Charles Darwin's great-great-grandson, started noticing how in the campaign run-up to the 2008 presidential election, none of the candidates were really talking about big science issues. And yet, these were the issues that were starting to impact everybody's life. They would talk about economics, even though they weren't economists. They would talk about foreign policy, even though they weren't diplomats. They would talk about their ideas about military intervention and where we should do that or not do that, even though they weren't generals. They even would talk about faith and values, something that had previously been considered a divisive topic in American politics because so many people have different views on that. But they wouldn't talk about science and engineering, the two things that were starting to affect every policy problem, every policy challenge that the United States is facing from the federal government on down to the local level. We're not just talking about environmental issues, we're talking about technological issues around privacy. We're talking about issues about the interface between law and neuroscience and technology, and what we're learning through computer science and neuroscience about how the brain works and how, in some cases, we can really impact that. That poses really interesting challenges about whether or not someone's responsible when they commit a crime and under what circumstances are they. All of these are problems that we have to begin to talk about in our politics and to codify in our policy and our legal system. And yet they weren't talking about them. So we started this organization called ScienceDebate.org. It was called ScienceDebate 2008 back then. And we put up a website calling on the candidates to start debating these issues. And it went viral. Within a couple of weeks, we had 38,000 scientists and engineers sign on, dozens of Nobel laureates, lots of members of Congress, tech company CEOs, and really influential leaders in kind of the cultural conversation. So we really struck a nerve. A lot of people realized that this was a big issue and that we were having a growing gap between what our politicians were talking about and what was happening in our society. And I want to explore that gap a little bit more with you tonight, because one thing that I learned there is that politicians don't really like talking about this. And there are a lot of reasons why that is the case. And yet, unless we do, we're going to lose control of self-governance over a lot of these issues. And that's starting to happen right now. In fact, to illustrate how much they don't want to talk about it, we hosted a science debate at the Franklin Institute in downtown Philadelphia. And we invited the candidates for president. We worked with PBS, who was going to broadcast it nationally. Paula Absol, the producer of Nova, was our producer. David Brancaccio, the host of a show called Now on PBS, but now you hear him on public radio, was going to be the moderator. And the candidates hemmed and hawed and then refused to come, and instead they debated faith and values at Messiah College in Harrisburg. And that really highlighted that interesting change that had happened in our public dialogue. And I set out to explore that, and that led me down this road to writing The War on Science. Now, in the years since, science has become kind of a political football, and it's become really acceptable in political dialogue to be anti-science, to say things that are completely contradicted by the established evidence. It used to be that if you did that, your career as a politician would be over. In the time of John F. Kennedy, for instance, that most certainly would have been the case, back when we were in a science race, in a space race. But now, something had changed. Politicians could deny evidence around climate change or around claim that vaccines cause autism and really not pay any kind of electoral penalty over it. It was happening in Congress, too. where particularly the climate issue was really charged, politically speaking, and driving a lot of divisive politics and a lot of science denial. But it wasn't just happening there, it was happening in legislatures across the country. For instance, in this case, when North Carolina passed a law banning sea level rise. This was a situation where the state legislature decided that local zoning officials could not use the scientific evidence suggesting what the sea level rise would be under climate change in making roadbed level decisions, in permitting new construction that was close to the ocean. Instead, they had to rely on the politically approved, politically correct numbers that the state legislature had passed. Sounded a lot more like Maoist China to me than the United States of America. But it's not just happening at state level, it's also happening at the city level. Now, Snowmass is just one of many cities, mostly more left-leaning cities, that have banned fluoride. Why is it more left-leaning cities? We'll get into that in a little bit, but it's an interesting aspect of the politics around science. Fluoride is actually considered one of the greatest public health achievements of the last 100 years, and yet cities are now banning it and removing it from their public water because some people think that it may lower your intelligence or that it may be some kind of poison. Then there's anti-science in pop culture. Big pop culture figures really don't feel embarrassed about embracing ideas that are critical of science, that question science, particularly in Robert De Niro's case, something again that's very common on the left, this false association between vaccinations and autism. So what is happening? What is going on in American society to have changed our political dialogue that makes science so politicized, so much of a hot topic, a hot potato, a football? Well, to begin to answer that, we have to go back to look at the founding of the United States. Wherever the people are well informed, Thomas Jefferson wrote, they can be trusted with their own government. But what happens now, some 240 years later? Can the people still be trusted with their own government? You know, about a generation ago, you could sit at your kitchen table and you could make a radio, or you could make a TV. You could even make an early computer out of parts. Science and engineering were much more a matter of know-how than they are today. An iPhone, if you take out your cell phone right now and you turn it over, you'll notice that it doesn't have any Phillips screws on the backside. You can't take it apart, and even if you could, it's too small. It's hard to figure out, just looking at it, how those parts work. And when that happens, when science, as Arthur C. Clarke once said, technology becomes sufficiently advanced, it becomes indistinguishable from magic. So these are rough equivalencies in today's world. They're both created by people cloistered away, wearing long robes and uttering strange incantations. Science and magic, science and opinion are becoming equivalencies. But the moment that science or technology becomes a matter of belief, we become vulnerable to disinformation campaigns. Because science is never about belief. It's about know-how. It's about breaking it down, figuring it out, putting it back together, testing it, understanding how it works, asking other people to test your conclusions about it, see if they get the same thing and that you've established an objective statement about the world. That's science. It's got nothing to do with belief. It has about as much to do with belief as being a plumber has to do with church. They're just not the same thing. But when we talk about whether or not we believe in science, it becomes a political issue that starts to interfere with our thought processes and our ability to self-govern. And I'll give you an example of this. This is another example kind of from the left. It occurs much more on the left. this fear that cell phones may cause brain cancer. Now, that's because they use microwave radiation, and radiation is a scary word for a lot of people because it's associated with, you know, nukes. And if you get exposed to radiation, it could kill you, right? But radiation is actually, we need it to live. It's called light. So like water, radiation is only dangerous in a matter of degree. We have problems when we can't see something, though, in scaling the relative risk. A water in the form of a stream nourishes us. In the form of a tidal wave, it's destructive. The same thing goes with radiation. Now, in 2011, the World Health Organization issued a report saying that your cell phones may be giving you brain cancer. May. Now, that's a scientifically true statement because anything may be true. But when I looked at the report, I noticed that the statistical blip that they found was below the noise level. It was indistinguishable from chance. So while it was a statistically true statement, it was practically false. Now, I'll explain really why. If you look at the NASA's electromagnetic spectrum there, you'll see that microwave radiation is a little bit more energetic than radio waves, but it's actually less energetic than the infrared radiation each of us is giving off as we sit here. You guys are probably all emitting about 70 to 90 watts of infrared radiation. That's why we have to have, you know, a cooling system, air conditioning system on, or we get pretty uncomfortably hot in here. So your bodies are more energetic, the photons you're giving off are more energetic than microwaves that your cell phone uses. It's not until you go all the way up through infrared, through visible light, to the top end of visible light, the bottom end of ultraviolet light, that a photon has enough energy to knock an electron out of a carbon atom, changing how it bonds chemically, thereby possibly altering your DNA and giving you cancer. But you have to know a little bit about physics, a little bit about chemistry, and a little bit about biology to know that a microwave photon just can't do that. In fact, that's part of really, stating in a different way, that's what Einstein got his Nobel Prize about. But if we don't have that technical knowledge and we don't have the ability to synthesize it, again, we become vulnerable to disinformation campaigns. And an example of bad policy then is after that report came out, the San Francisco City Council Board of Supervisors, all of them Democrats, voted 10-1 to require every cell phone shop in San Francisco to warn you that your cell phone may cause brain cancer. Now, that is an example of bad policy because it's based on fear, it's based on what's called the avoidance principle, but it's not based on evidence. Just because you're afraid that something might happen is not a good reason to base public policy on it. So we've got this growing gap between all of these different issues that have a political impact in our life. Remember, at the beginning of the scientific revolution, Francis Bacon said that knowledge is power, right? Well, what is a tool for creating knowledge? It's science. Science creates knowledge. Knowledge is power. That power is political because it either confirms or challenges somebody's vested interests. And that makes science a political issue. It's not partisan, but it's political. And in all of these different cutting-edge areas where new technology and new science is emerging, we are stuck. And we have been stuck for some time on some of them. And if you think about that, you can understand why it's starting to pose a challenge to democracy. Now, anybody want to venture a guess? I don't know if you can see it in this light here, but there are a lot of blue lines there connecting different spots on the globe. Anybody want to guess what those might represent? Just shout it out. Well, they're Facebook connections. You can see in particular that China is mostly dark there. We call that the Great Firewall of China. They block Facebook and a lot of other Western social media and internet connections. But they might as well be representing the connections between scientists and science labs around the world. We have experienced a fundamental change in the way that we do science in the last 20 years because of the internet. Scientists are no longer geographically required to work together in the same lab. They can collaborate over the internet. They can be in different time zones, in different countries. At the same time that we're seeing this qualitative shift in how we do science, we're seeing a quantitative shift in the number of scientists. So those two things combined mean that we are going to create as much new knowledge over the next 20 to 40 years as we've created over the last 400 years. So if you think about how many political arguments we've had to have about the knowledge that we've created, things like, does the Earth go around the sun or the other way around? Things like, is evolution a thing? Does it challenge our moral or religious underpinnings of society? What do all these discoveries that science is producing mean? And it becomes apparent that we're going to get stuck in an endless mire of conversations that we're not going to be able to find a way out of. So we've got to find a better system for more rapidly and clearly incorporating rapidly advancing scientific knowledge into our policymaking framework so that we can continue to govern ourselves successfully. There are countries who can do this. China is leapfrogging over us in a lot of ways right now because they are a partially authoritarian society. I think 9 out of the 10 Politburo members are engineers, so they understand this. But that kind of command and control approach is not the way that we do business in America. And it's not what we really believe is going to lead to the best outcomes ultimately. So we need to figure out how to rise to this challenge. So the question is are the people still well enough informed to be trusted with their own government? I think those signs go well together. Judging from Congress, the answer is probably not. There they are, all hard at work on their laptops. How many out of the 535 members of Congress, how many do you suppose have a professional degree in science or background? It's 11. Less than 2%. There is a microbiologist, a physicist, he's the only PhD in Congress, and a chemist and 6 engineers, or 8 engineers, I guess. It's up by 2 this cycle. By contrast, how many lawyers do you think we have? What was that? Most of them? Not quite most, but a huge chunk. 41% of them are lawyers. So it's little wonder that we see a more legalistic approach and a lack of understanding about science in Congress, because lawyers and scientists approach a problem of fact in very different ways. An attorney is going to do discovery and research both sides of an issue in order to see what the opposition might argue to be better prepared to argue for your predetermined conclusion that you are then going to rely on the judge, the jury, or in the case of Congress, the body as a whole, to judge who's made the most compelling argument. That's the exact opposite of what science does. That's an anti-science approach, starting with the conclusion and working backwards. What science does is it starts with observation of nature. It poses questions, it does tests, and then it even-handedly looks at what the answer might be. And if we're going to incorporate advanced scientific knowledge in our policymaking process, we need scientists and the scientific point of view to be included in that. So what's driving all of this? As I said earlier, science is never partisan, but it's always political. How could that be? It's because we often think about politics as a left-right spectrum, but that's really not the whole picture. We think about it in terms of progressives on the left and conservatives on the right. A scientist actually has to be both progressive and conservative. If they're going to publish on something, they're going to have to account for all the known, quote-unquote, traditional values, the knowledge that has come before and has been retained into the present because it's of value. Otherwise, they could end their career by publishing prematurely on something and being proven wrong. On the other hand, they also have to be open to change because the cutting edge is where the research really pays off. And if you're not open to change, you risk career stagnation, another form of career suicide. So good scientists are both conservative and progressive, but they are decidedly political because there is another aspect of our politics between authoritarianism and what was classically called liberalism. And democracy is a form of government that is on the top of that chart there because it takes nothing on faith. It says, show me the evidence. I'm not going to go with something just because you say it's so. On the other hand, there are authoritarians who often dismiss science, undercut it, defund it, kill scientists, imprison scientists. You could imagine on the left, on the bottom, the more authoritarian end, Chairman Mao, the Cultural Revolution, highly authoritarian, left wing. On the right, you could imagine Hitler or Mussolini. Interestingly enough, both of those regimes that I mentioned started out by wanting to embrace science. Hitler actually was a very early adopter of a lot of science and technology. But as they became more and more restrictive, jailing scientists whose conclusions were politically challenging to them, they pushed knowledge creators out of the country, and they began to fail. So if we look at how this became political, we have to look at the broader narrative line of US politics and see why people feel the way they do, because a lot of it is an emotional reaction in the public. And it used to be about 100 years ago that science was quickly commercialized in the form of new technology. It was a job creator, drove a lot of economic development, created fortunes, and it was a big source of American pride. But at the end of World War II, our attitude towards science really transformed after we dropped the atomic bomb. There were a lot of moral and ethical discussions at the time about whether we'd become technological giants and moral and ethical infants. And there was a sense that science and the scientific-industrial military complex had outgrown our ability to control our impulses. But that negative view began to switch very quickly in 1957 with the advent of Sputnik. And suddenly, 8 years after the Soviets had exploded their atomic bomb, we were vulnerable because maybe it's possible that they might put one in space shortly and drop them on us. So suddenly, because of this military reason, Americans felt themselves in a space race, and that really meant a science race, to really understand how to do this, how to control space, but also all the research that was necessary that was an offshoot of that. After World War II, a guy named Vannevar Bush had proposed peacetime funding of science and technology by the government in a paper called Science, the Endless Frontier. And he made the argument that if we did that, like we had done during World War II, America would become the preeminent power because science and technology created power, new knowledge, and it would drive our economy forward. And he was right. After Sputnik, all these different government science agencies were funded, NSF, NIH, all of them, and we began seeing this new era of government science that was producing dizzyingly quick breakthroughs. But at the same time that we entered that science race, scientists themselves pulled themselves out of the public dialogue. Up until that point, scientists had to go out to speak to standing room only crowds of people about their new discoveries. This was fascinating, but also ginned up support from the public to fund their research. Well, now that they had public dollars, they felt, we have to be responsible with this money, because if we fund something that's stupid, we're going to get a black eye and we're going to get defunded. So they set up these panels of scientists who would judge other scientists' grant proposals, but they forgot about that public engagement piece and this link between the public and the scientists that they were supporting began to atrophy. In 1962, that transformed into worry about science with the publication of Silent Spring, the idea that chemicals rapidly commercialized after World War II were now in the environment and they could be destroying the environment and destroying our health too. The creation of environmental science and the environmental movement happened after the publication of that book. At about the same time, we were having a big moral and ethical discussion over the growing human control of the reproductive cycle. There was discussion back then, particularly by religious conservatives, over whether or not test tube babies, as they were called back then, we now call them in vitro fertilization, whether they would have souls like everybody else. So this kind of moral questioning and ethical divide over these two issues, the biological sciences and the environmental sciences, created a split in American politics that we're still dealing with today. On the right, their threatened industry, petrochemical industries, tobacco industries, all these industries whose business models were threatened by new revelations in science, kind of wound up, teamed up with old-time religion, whose views were more literalist and fundamentalist about what the Bible should say about how we live our lives, and had moral objections to what science was saying. On the left, science and environmentalists wound up being together. And if you think about our politics today, this is really starting to come to fruition. There was another big factor, though, that complicated this, and that was the end of the Cold War. Remember that funding that we got for science after Sputnik? That began to nosedive as soon as the Cold War was over, and it became increasingly politically acceptable then for members of Congress to question science and to take anti-science positions. Where they had paid electoral penalties before, now there was no penalty. So all of these factors began to create a new kind of politics that we hadn't seen in America before. On the right, the theme was creeping socialism. And the anti-science, the denial of the evidence, because it, remember, creates power, and sometimes that power challenges somebody's vested interests. So it was denial of climate change, denial of evolution, objections to human reproduction, and more recently, vaccination, particularly over HPV vaccine, because of moral and ethical questions about whether or not being vaccinated against a cause of cervical cancer would encourage young girls to have sex. On the left, it's more about hidden dangers. The ideas of the environmental movement are taken to an extreme, and we see more of a kind of an ethos of back to Eden. And the anti-science there is generally against mainstream medicine, suspicion of mainstream medicine, the idea that cell phones can cause brain cancer, vaccination can cause autism, that EMF pollution can interfere with your health, that fluoridation is poisoning you, and that genetically modified food is unsafe to eat. The motivation on the right is anti-regulation, anti-reproductive control, and pro-corporate. It's pretty plain. On the left, the motivation is pro-environment, pro-regulation, pro-choice, and anti-corporate. Did I say anti-corporate before? I meant pro-corporate. And the theme then, on the right, is liberal scientists with a socialist agenda want to control your life and limit your freedom. And on the left, it's impersonal doctors, greedy corporations, and mechanistic scientists hide the real dangers to our health and our spirit. So when you look at this, you can see most of the conversation and arguments that are going on in our politics today are kind of embedded in this discussion that we're having about the role of science and evidence in our public policy. And almost all of this has happened without the input of scientists themselves in the process. It's just a lot of non-scientists nattering away about these things, which is a problem. So who's doing this? Who's driving a lot of this? Well, there are three major battlefields: the identity politics war, the ideological front, and the industrial war on science. So let's talk about each of them. The identity politics war is really something that has come out of the academic left. This is the idea that really came up again after World War II, that science was just another way of knowing. No better or worse than indigenous ways of knowing, or black ways of knowing, or whatever, you know, LGBT ways of knowing, whatever identity politics group that you wanted to plug in, they had their truth, and it wasn't objective, our claims to objective knowledge that gave us authority. It was our authenticity. If you were a white man, you couldn't speak for a black woman. Challenge to writers, because actually to be a good writer, you should be able to do that. And that's actually been a discussion that's gone on in literary circles for some time now. But this idea has really developed in academia to become a major problem. I'll give you one example. A friend of mine he's a professor, and he teaches screenwriting at a college, and he was sitting on the tenure committee in this English department, and he was in the back of the room kind of watching a teacher teach, evaluating her, and he heard her say that we can't know that the Earth goes around the sun. And she was telling students why she felt this. And after class, he pulled her aside and said, that was just kind of a rhetorical thing, right? You're just kind of prodding them to get a discussion going. And she said, no, we can't know that. There have been all kinds of revolutions that have overturned prior worldviews. Aren't you aware of that? So he brought this concern that he had to the rest of the tenure committee, because this is a publicly funded college. And he said, you know, the whole idea of publicly funded schools, universities, the idea that Jefferson challenged or embraced in funding of public education was to have an informed citizenry. It was a civic duty. And if we're going to be fulfilling that mission, we can't have somebody that's teaching something that's completely contrary to the evidence. I mean, you can look at pictures and you can see that the Earth is going around the sun. And the tenure committee thought about it and they said, well, no. Haven't you read Thomas Kuhn, The Structure of Scientific Revolutions? Worldviews are overturned all the time. We can't really count on what science says. Just because science says it, that doesn't mean that it's the end all and be all. So they kept her on, and he was defeated and disgusted. But is science just a white male power claim? A meta-narrative, as postmodernists say, of the reigning culture to keep everybody else in line. Well, it doesn't matter what your identity group is, if you stick a ruler in a dish of water after it rains, you're going to get the same measurement that I am. That's objective knowledge. It's tied to the object being measured, not to the subjective identity of the person doing the measuring. And that was the whole point of the scientific method, was to strip what we know away from all these sources of bias and these different ways that we confuse ourselves. So postmodernism, really, you know, science is about modernism. It's a creation of the modern era, and postmodernism is trying to move beyond that objectivity. So how does this play out in the real world? Beyond being irritating in academia, there's education programs and journalism programs that have taught for two generations that there's really no such thing as objectivity. J-school, it's a big deal. And it's intended as an admonishment to be careful because you have your own biases that you bring. But it's gotten to the point now where it's being taught as kind of a mantra, and journalists approach this issue taking it literally, that there is no such thing as objectivity. Here's an example, Voice of San Diego, new reporter guidelines, just one of many, every reporter guideline virtually has this. I'm not picking on them. In fact, the Society of Professional Journalists removed the idea of being objective from their code of ethics in 1994. So this is a big problem in journalism. There it is, no such thing as objectivity. Famous journalists repeat it on the speaking trail. Linda Ellerbe, no such thing as objectivity. Even Nick Gillespie, the editor-in-chief of Reason.com, an objectivist publication, is saying there's no such thing as objectivity. You'd think if anybody believed in objectivity, it would be Nick Gillespie. So what does this create? How does this play out then? Well, journalists will say there's always two sides to every story. Right? Bob says 2 plus 2 is 4, Julie says it's 6, the controversy rages. Maybe Julie has a legitimate perspective or reason for her perspective. Scientists will say, well, sorry to say, but most times one side is simply wrong, and I can show you with these apples that Bob is clearly right. And then we got the politicians. How about a compromise? And that's kind of Washington in a nutshell right now. So it's no wonder that our policy discussion starts to drift away from reality when we are thinking like this, and when the main feedback mechanism in a democracy, journalism, is giving us bogus information. Why is it a problem and how does it play out? It creates something called false balance, where journalists will dedicate half of a story to a scientist who's presenting you with the objective knowledge that scientists have been able to develop through thousands of painstaking experiments, some scientists dying, as frequently happens in different areas, depending on what they're researching, to create this knowledge for the rest of us. And on the other half of the story, or the other half of the screen, they put somebody with an opinion. And that person with an opinion will likely be much more charismatic in articulating that opinion because they're driven by the passion of proving to you that they're right. Whereas a scientist is just relaying what we know. That creates a situation called false balance where extreme views and unsupported opinions are elevated in our political dialogue. And that's a huge challenge for us in democracy. That's journalists not doing their job. Then there's the ideological war on science. This is one that is founded in moral and ethical objections to new scientific advances, as we've already discussed. Human control over the reproductive cycle, all kinds of issues around sexuality and reproduction, as well as issues around evolution. Largely, it's when science has treaded into an area that biblical literalists or fundamentalists regard as God's territory, and that science shouldn't be figuring out anything about that. Now, it's not just there. Billy Graham, in 1949, made a big career starting then, ripping on science, and talking about how men had become, had knocked God off the pedestal and put man up, and we were going to end in nuclear annihilation. This has become a civil war of values, as James Dobson put it. And it's perfectly healthy and good to have moral and ethical discussions about scientific advances. In fact, that's the only way we actually are able to codify them into law and establish norms for how we treat them in society. That's a good thing. Churches are houses of moral and ethical reflection, and we need their views on this. But where churches run into a problem is when they start denying the evidence in favor of protecting what they view as their power base. Science came out of religion. Came out of Protestant religion. So it's ironic that a lot of the opposition to science comes from, these days, Protestant preachers. Because Protestants always said, you know, I'm not going to listen to what the Catholic preachers and the Pope say. I'm going to read the Bible and see for myself. And that kind of anti-authoritarian idea is really what science grew out of in England. So when we get into protecting our vested interests instead of using what we have to morally and ethically reflect, then we're doing a disservice to everybody. The beauty that churches could offer is if the preachers and pastors were members of the AAAS, or members, or followed the proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, or even read Scientific American magazine, or any of the other similar popular science magazines, they could lead their parishioners in moral and ethical discussions of the cutting edge stuff that we need to get past. That would be a huge help. The last of the three battlefields is the industrial war on science. And like the other battlefields, this is where science is posing some kind of existential threat to somebody's worldview, either an ideological worldview or, in this case, an economic threat. The primary strategy is to use public relations campaigns to create uncertainty. And it's almost always about regulation, opposing regulation. This is where science has discovered something. You know, product has been quickly commercialized, and then 10, 15 years later, we say, well, wait a minute, we didn't realize that it was going to do this negative thing over here. We really should regulate in order to correct that so that industry isn't dumping or externalizing risk or health issues onto other people, third parties. And in all of these areas, instead of adapting, a public relations method has been developed that is almost universal in the way that it is applied. To understand PR, you have to realize that it was originally called propaganda. Edward Bernays is the creator of public relations. He's considered the father of public relations, and he was part of something called the Creel Committee. This was something that Woodrow Wilson put together to convince Americans that we should go into World War I. Americans didn't want to. We wanted to stay out of it. And this committee created an immersive public relations environment. If you went to the movies, you would see little trailers talking about the evils of Germany and why we needed to get into World War I. If you read the paper, you would see similar ads. There were posters everywhere you went. And this immersive argument was successful. After that happened, Bernays was really struck by the power of what they had discovered, what they'd accomplished. And he wrote this book called Propaganda that the Nazis then used as their model for propaganda. So Nazi propaganda is essentially based on the principles of American public relations. Now, Bernays wanted to perfect this, so he went to his uncle, Sigmund Freud, and he asked him for what can we incorporate from psychology to make this even more powerful. And Freud gave him a lot of insights, and one of Bernays's first successful efforts for industry was co-opting the suffragist movement. A cigarette company that he worked for, that he was hired for, wanted to double their market share. Back then, women didn't smoke hardly at all, and certainly not in public. It was considered something that prostitutes did, and not something that decent women did. And so how do you overcome this? Well, Bernays talked to his uncle, and they talked about how cigarettes were kind of phallic, and there was all these different psychological and psychosexual aspects to them, but they also realized that it was a symbol of freedom. And they adopted, this is kind of the first instance of corporations adopting this idea of American freedom and using it for their own ends. And he hired, using something called the third party technique, he hired a bunch of attractive women to walk down Fifth Avenue in New York City in the Easter Parade. He didn't do it himself though. He hired a famous suffragist to hire them because it's important that nobody know that he was actually the player behind the scenes pulling all the strings. And then he had his own photographers taking pictures of them, and they were calling them, as they were smoking, torches of freedom. So cigarettes became torches of freedom. It was covered in lots and lots of newspapers around the country. It was a brilliant PR victory, and women took up smoking in a big way. So this idea of public relations then really took hold as the decades went forward. Another example comes from another industry that is facing what they consider an existential challenge, the energy industry, and from the science indicating climate change. So what did they do? In 1968, they hired Stanford Research Institute to do a report, and in fact, SRA basically said, we expect some significant temperature changes. They're almost certain to occur by the year 2000, and they could bring about climactic change. Turns out they're pretty much right on the money. In fact, climate science is, you know, it's 150 years old, so it's not like it's that uncertain. Carbon dioxide and its relationship with light and heat is pretty well established. So what did the companies do? Well, the American Petroleum Institute hired a bunch of people to come up with a PR plan called the Global Climate Science Communications Action Plan. And their goal was to create uncertainty about the science. And if you look at their statements here, it's pretty striking. There's the word uncertainty. The goal is when the majority of American public, including industry leadership, recognizes that significant uncertainties exist in climate science. And we've got uncertainties again here. Victory will be achieved when average citizens understand, in quotes, uncertainties in climate science. There it is again. Recognition of uncertainties becomes part of the conventional wisdom. Media understands uncertainties in climate science. We see uncertainties throughout, and that the validity of viewpoints that challenge the current conventional wisdom are accepted. So, and by the way, here is the first instance that I know of climate change being spelled the way that Donald Trump spelled it in his answers to us, in scare quotes. This strategy takes advantage of an inherent aspect of science that is based on the type of inductive reasoning that it uses. All science is uncertain. Science is not in the business of making certain statements about anything. I'll give you an example. You look out the window and you see white swans. You go to the store, you see more white swans in a pond. Everywhere you look, there are white swans. Can you conclude that therefore all swans are white? No, because somewhere there might be a non-white swan. So because science can't see all of the universe simultaneously at once, it holds out the mathematical possibility, even if it's not very great, that there might be a non-white swan. That's where math and statistics come into science, because we calculate the relative probability that a statement is true, and we say whether it's well supported or not. But we're never going to say that it's certain. We will say that it's well supported. We will say that that it should be regarded as settled or settled facts, which is what the National Academy of Sciences says about climate change. But we won't say that it's certain. And so industry takes advantage of that. So there's a seven-stage strategy now to emphasize that uncertainty. And it starts with fake journals and fake science that basically starts with a predetermined conclusion and then develops the science necessary to support it. Then we go to slanted press materials that go out to bloggers. And then front groups whip up grassroots anger and support in order to support the industry position. The scientists for hire then proselytize to thought leaders in different communities about this issue and create the uncertainty, emphasize the uncertainty. Once this is picked up in the press, then the story is amplified by the yellow media, the slanted media, the Fox News outlets of the world, and creating a broad mainstream din now. And then there's a policy to address the problem, which is really not a problem, but it's become a problem now, is proposed by industrial allies and government. And then finally, at that point, the innocent corporate actors that are really behind all of this, financing this PR campaign, can step out from behind the curtain like the Wizard of Oz, and they can plead their case before Congress and the public. And this is a strategy, seven steps that are now used over and over and over again. And I'm going to give you an example of how brilliantly it worked to stop the climate bill in its tracks in 2008. Here's Obama in his first address to Congress, first one after taking office.
I ask this Congress to send me legislation that places a market-based cap on carbon pollution and drives the production of more renewable energy in America.
All right. Congress did just that a few months later.
The bill is passed.
Okay, they needed some Republican votes to do it. They got eight Republicans to vote for it, and it passed. The Senate was controlled by Democrats. He had a Democrat president. Looks like a done deal, right? Not so fast. Americans for Prosperity is an organization founded and largely financed by Koch Industries founders, the Koch brothers. And it is roughly four times the size of the Republican Party. Huge player in public relations. They got active on this issue right away. Here's their president, Tim Phillips.
I'm Tim Phillips, president of Americans for Prosperity. We're here in Billings, Montana.
We certainly did TV ads, radio ads, social media. We did rallies, events. We launched something we called Hot Air.
And we're sending the message to Senator Baucus and Senator Tester to vote no on this job-killing, tax-increasing cap and trade.
We got a hot air balloon, put a banner on the side of it that said cap and trade means higher taxes, lost jobs, less freedom. And we went all over the country doing events and stirring up grassroots anger and frustration, concern.
Cap and trade will slow the economy and cost American jobs.
Notice that word freedom again. Freedom, that's a constant PR strategy. Then the spin artist got busy testifying before Congress.
Right response to the non-problem of global warming, first slide please, is to have the courage to do nothing.
But the fear of catastrophic man-made global warming is mistaken.
This demonstration shows that the oft-repeated mantra in Washington, quote, the science is settled, is not true at all.
It's interesting to note that AFP, Americans for Prosperity, and the Cato Institute were both founded by Koch brothers. Then scientists for hire went out into communities to spread doubt and uncertainty among thought leaders, the doctors, the lawyers, the campaign donors in senators' home districts.
Tell me that there hasn't been any perceptible trend.
In the last 10 years, there hasn't been a warming. We don't know why that is, but one doesn't see any warming in the observations.
Okay, so Gavin Schmidt from NASA explains why what Fred Singer is saying is actually false.
You could take the entire climate history that we have in the instrumental record and you could find cooling trends every 10 years.
Cooling trends between 1958 and 1969, 1969 and 1978, 1978 and 1987, and so on. Scientists have a name for this. They call it going down the up escalator.
You pick the endpoints, and you could find any particular year as part of a cooling year. But actually, the whole thing has been moving up.
If you look at all of the data, it's quite clear that the warming is continuing.
This is a classic statistical trick. Similar tricks are things like p-hacking, where, well, I won't go into it, but there are a lot of them that you can use to fool people with numbers by picking your endpoints. At the same time, they targeted Bob Inglis and the other Republicans who voted for this bill, and they targeted them in primary battles in their own home districts.
Now, how many times has an incumbent who isn't in prison or facing a prison sentence lost his own primary by 79% to 21%? This was overwhelming. But what's happened is...
The smile on your face suggests, man, we won one.
Of course we won one.
We're on the record. And our grandchildren or great-grandchildren are going to read.
This climate hearing in the lame duck Congress was Inglis's last.
Your child is sick. 98 doctors say treat him this way. Two say no, this other is the way to go. I'll go with the two. you're taking a big risk with those kids.
Thank you, Mr. English.
It was a very key factor in 10 to 15 congressional districts in the 2010 election, where strong supporters of climate change legislation ended up being defeated.
And there is nothing like a loss in an election to promote fear in the survivors. And that's exactly what happened in the United States Congress.
The amazing thing about this is they didn't target senators. They targeted House members. And they didn't target them in the general election. They targeted them in primary. Why? Because they wanted to create this sense of a further right groundswell rising up from the public, opposing cap and trade legislation, to put that fear into the senators that were going to vote on it in the next coming months. So then you saw a remarkable change when the president of the Senate stood in front of those TV cameras and said he no longer had the votes to pass climate legislation. It was probably the most stunning and brilliant public relations victory in the history of public relations. For a very relatively small investment of money, $100 million or so, they changed the course of United States politics. So why does all this matter? I go back to Jefferson. When Jefferson was sitting there in that hot rented room in Philadelphia, trying to craft the Declaration of Independence to convince the other Enlightenment nations, science-driven Enlightenment nations, to stay out of the Revolutionary War, because his life depended on it and all the revolutionary lives depended on it, he tried to create the most powerful arguments that he could to convince them. So he went to his trinity of three greatest men, is what he called them. He was a scientist as well as a lawyer, just like Francis Bacon was before him. And the trinity of three greatest men, you can still see them, their paintings hanging in his home, were Isaac Newton, Francis Bacon, and John Locke. And what he did, without going into all the details, was he synthesized their thinking into essentially the idea that if anyone can discover the truth of something for him or herself using the tools of science and reason, then no king, no pope, and no wealthy lord is more entitled to govern us than we are ourselves. Democracy is an anti-authoritarian form of government. This idea was self-evident. Government based on evidence. So the way that Jefferson saw it playing out was something like this, the virtuous circle of democracy, where you have you're presented with a governance issue, some problem that has come up that needs discussing and addressing. You go to the educated and informed mass of the people. That's why Jefferson was an advocate for public education and a free press, to educate children to be good citizens and to keep adults informed to make wise decisions. Then they would commission scientific research and develop knowledge about that problem, and then you would debate the best policy based on that knowledge. And so it would go. Where we get into trouble with public relations then is when vested interests create alternative theories like intelligent design or propaganda like climate denial and pass them out to adults and children to confuse the issue. Then, instead of commissioning scientific research to build knowledge, we turn to authority and ideology for knowledge. Then instead of debating the best policy based on knowledge, we debate the best policy based on dogma. And what does that do? It transforms democracy into authoritarianism. I'm just going to show you, I just got one or two more slides, but this is kind of a complicated one. I spent a lot of time on it, so I hope you like it. This is a little story. I don't know if there's any Mellencamp fans in the audience, but there's a story about Jack and Diane. And this shows you kind of how this plays out in our everyday lives, in our emotional lives. So Jack's a lawyer, and Diane's a scientist, and they're madly in love. One day Jack goes to work, and at lunch, he goes out with a bunch of guys, and they hear Fred Singer talking about, we don't know why there's not been any warming, but the evidence doesn't show that there's been any warming for the last 10 years, right? And so he you know, goes back to the office and he's thinking about that. And he checks out, you know, some of the news feeds before he gets back into work, and he sees, oh, wait a minute, NOAA's fiddling with climate data to erase the 15-year global warming hiatus? Well, that doesn't sound right. Sounds like somebody's trying to prove their point. We can't count on that science. Then, of course, he talks to the guys, and kind of peer pressure kicks in, because they say, yeah, I saw that one too. And but you know, that Fred Singer, he was pretty darn smart, wasn't he? He was a smart guy. So he's got this kind of emotional thing about tying in with his colleagues and wanting to be part of the group. And their conclusion is that this is all BS. So, you know, he's a little bit on the defensive about it. His wife is a scientist, you know, so he decides to check it out online some more. And he finds this report, looks like a legitimate report, published by the NIPCC, the Non-Governmental International Panel on Climate Change, saying why there's uncertainty. Well, the Non-Governmental International Panel on Climate Change is not the real IPCC, the International or the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. This is actually a report by the Heartland Institute, which is funded by a lot of private vested interests, including energy industry money, to look like an actual scientific report to create more confusion. So he finds that, and then on the drive home, of course, he's tunes in Rush. Rush is always fun to listen to, and Rush says that this is a big hoax, and it's, the target is you, the people of the United States of America. And he's thinking about this. All this stuff is spinning around in his head, and you know, he thinks about this newspaper that he gets. Every policymaker in America gets this thing mailed to them from the Heartland Institute. And as a government relations guy, he gets it. And of course, there it is again, talking about how this really isn't settled. This is really uncertain. So he's getting it from multiple angles. And that's the important thing, because all of these little bits and pieces, what are they? They're tantamount to evidence. He's not a scientist, but he's getting little bits and pieces of evidence. On the drive home, of course, he passes a billboard talking about how wind dies and sun sets and we should have clean coal, back clean coal. At home, he's cooking dinner, you know, he's trying to be a good husband, the wife is stuck at the lab, cooking dinner for the kids, and turns on the news and they're talking about that how NASA or NOAA faked the data again. So when she comes home, he talks to her about it. He says, you know, I don't know, what should I believe? And she says, no, that's not, all that stuff is nonsense. Here's the real data. So she takes him online and she shows him the real data. All right, this is the one bit of real evidence that he's got. So, you know, he goes, it's time to tuck his daughter in, but she's still working on her homework. So he sits down next to her and he helps her on her homework. And what does her textbook say? Well, it says, scientists agree that the Earth's climate is changing. They do not agree on what is causing the change. Is it just another natural warming cycle, like so many cycles that have occurred in the past? Scientists who support this position cite thousands of years worth of natural climatic change as evidence. Or is climatic change anthropogenic, caused by human activity? Scientists who support this position cite the warming effect of rapidly increasing amounts of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. More uncertainty. This is, again, language that came out of the Heartland Institute. In school textbooks, science textbooks. Then he decides, all right, I'm going to post the real information out there. So maybe my colleagues at work will see it. You know, I'm just going to do kind of a drop and run. So he posts this thing on Facebook, and what happens? He finds himself in a Facebook smackdown. And not only are some of his colleagues smacking him down, but their friends and their friends of friends, and suddenly he's in this big battle. He's in over his head. He's not really well equipped to argue this, so he can't handle it, and he's embarrassed. So he feels like crap, and all these voices are sticking to him now with this kind of negative feeling, like, don't you stick yourself out there. So what does he do? Well, he does a little bit more research, and a friend on Facebook says, well, you know, I like you, Jack, but you're a little misguided. Check out this article in Natural News. It's more about uncertainty, right? 30,000 scientists say man-made global warming is a complete hoax. Of course, they don't tell you that those scientists, quote-unquote scientists, are people with a bachelor's of science degree. That qualifies them as being a scientist. Then he goes to church, takes his daughter to church. It's a nice big mega church, but it's aligned with the Cornwall Alliance, who believe in man's dominion over nature and that the world is not going to end in a flood, that God controls that, and that we should not be worrying about interfering with that. We shouldn't be so arrogant. So he's getting it from his faith community as well. He does a little bit more reading to get both sides of the debate, which is where we want him, right? And he sees, he goes on to Breitbart, good reliable source of information, and he sees all kinds of stuff about the uncertainty and about climate change skeptics. So he goes back to work on Monday and he talks to his friend who says, you know, hey, don't worry about it. Debate is good, right? All debate is good. Not realizing that actually all debate isn't good when some of it isn't based on any evidence and you're not willing to change your position based on the evidence. Then all debate is not good. So he goes out later that night for beers with a client, and they're snowed out by an unusually cold day, and the client says, oh, some global warming, huh? And notice what this is doing to his relationship with Diane. He turns on the TV, and there's Senator Inhofe with his snowball on the Senate floor as evidence that, of course, climate change isn't happening. How could anybody be so stupid? So what does he do? He goes along to get along. It's a lot easier, right? All these sources of evidence from his world seem to be pushing him in that direction. But unfortunately, this starts dividing him from his wife. So he uses sexism and rationalization to account for it. She's just a tree hugger and she's just a woman, right? So he can discount her and compartmentalize that relationship. 2 years later, they get divorced, and she cites this as the moment that she lost him. So Jack and Diane's story is a little bit of a tragedy. But what it does is it shows how all of these things, from his perspective, are evidence. And they are all cross-confirming each other. He's become trapped in a propaganda web, a sort of pre-engineered virtual reality that has used all these different mechanisms in society to reaffirm the conclusion that we want them to have. Now, the other thing about this is that it creates a sort of what scientists call a tarball, where all of these different issues start to get wrapped up. And any one of these points of entry can pull him into this undertow that he mentally really will find it very, very difficult to escape from. And once you're in that, you're vulnerable to all the other disinformation campaigns, the anti-science campaigns, because they use the same technique and they cross-pollinate and cross-confirm each other as well. So it becomes a self-contained ideological identity and worldview. That becomes extraordinarily powerful. And it's very, very difficult to escape from. It's as difficult to escape from as it is people who are in a cult, because it involves your identity and it causes a lot of cognitive dissonance to think about challenging that. We can have some sympathy for people who get caught in these kinds of webs, propaganda webs. Why is this really, really important, though? Think about these quotes. It's a worldwide hoax. It's money-making industry, and it's a hoax, the greatest hoax ever perpetrated. Well, a similar thing happened in Weimar Germany in 1920, where anti-relativity activists engaged in a PR campaign. They dogged Albert Einstein, traveled around Germany, casting doubts on him, holding big rallies. and creating uncertainty about relativity theory. They called it a hoax in Jewish science. Einstein said, "This world is a strange madhouse. Currently, every coachman and every waiter is debating whether relativity theory is correct. Belief in this matter depends on political party affiliation." Does that sound familiar at all? So what can we do to win the war on science? I'm going to go through these quite quickly since we're nearing the end and I want to have room for questions. But the war on science really is a fundamental authoritarian attack on democracy. And what we need to do is we need to stop it. We need to tell industry leaders to stop it. You've got to find better ways to work with scientific advances. We've got to tell religious leaders to stop it. We've got to tell academics on the left to stop it. Because what's at stake is our ability to govern ourselves with the facts and with evidence. So there are some strategies that get to tackling this on an institutional level. One is to create a National Center for Science and Self-Governance that looks at all these issues and that promulgates suggested policy platforms, much like some other groups do, that could help change the public dialogue. Journalists really need to stop the false balance. Their job is not to present both sides even-handedly when one side has no evidence. Their job is to hold the powerful accountable to the evidence. That's the whole point of having journalists in a free society. Because the powerful will do what they want unless there's the rudder of journalism to provide the check and balance of the people. Industry, stop it. We need to take a broader view of shareholder value. Even the Supreme Court, even Antonin Scalia wrote an opinion that there is no inherent reason why corporations need to only strictly protect shareholder value. There's no legal reason for that. That's an aberration in corporate thinking. Corporations are really there to make life better. They're there to make life better for their customers by creating a product that saves time, money, or makes life easier. They're there to create value and make life better for their shareholders by making money, but they're also there to make life better for their employees and for the communities that they're in. So we need to take a broader view. And don't just engage in brutal science denial when it poses a challenge. Open access journals would be, they're starting, but that would be a really helpful way for journalists and science writers and the general public to have access to level one knowledge, firsthand knowledge. Granting bodies really need to do a much better job of getting scientists out communicating with the public to bridge this huge communication gap that we've got going and repair it. The media needs to stop the fake science shows. Discovery Channel, pull it back a notch. There's students who think that this is science. You know, they show up in class and they think that Bigfoot is real and that the Loch Ness Monster is real. In education, we need to speak up for and stress process, because science is not about the outcome, it's about the how-to, the process of how we know things and what to do. Faith leaders, again, as I mentioned this, read science magazines and have these discussions. They can be incredibly fruitful and stimulating. And talk about being relevant in people's lives and driving people to your congregation. Science organizations need to coordinate with disempowered groups a lot more, because science, again, through the ideas of Thomas Jefferson, is really the foundation of the idea that we are all created equal, which is where civil rights comes from. Universities need to step back to the extent that they can and to the extent that state legislatures will allow them, because they've had so much funding cuts, but step back from revenue-driven funding to the extent that they can, and to take a broader view of education. It's not just about learning what you need, the skills you need to get a job. It's about learning how to think. It's about learning the process, the how-to of it all. Attorneys really need to use the legal system to defend democracy from denial, because attacks on science are attacks on democracy. And scientists need to do a lot better job of speaking out. A lot of strategies there that we can, you know, talk about at some other time, but it's really about using inclusive bridging language. It's not about creating this culture war narrative and putting people in their respective boxes. Every faith perspective is important. Every industrial investment is important. Every philosophical question about what knowledge is important. But so is evidence. So is science. And we're smarter than just walling that off in its own separate field. So one of the things that we're doing is we're, through science debate, is we're supporting the March for Science. We are the fiscal sponsor of that. I don't know if there's going to be one here, but there are about 300 of them around the world on Earth Day. And beyond that, I think I'll stop here and take questions. Thank you.